Pondcast. He is DJ Schweitzer. I am Jeremy Lance. Season 8. Here we are. It started a lot. It came a lot quicker than we thought, you know, given when season 7 ended, like, I don't know, a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I kind of felt like I took a nap and yeah. I woke back up and it was time to start recording season 8. They said that we'd never make it to season 8. I'm lying. No one said that, because literally no one
said anything about anything related to it.
Yeah. But yet here we are, eight years down the line from the first time we sat together and recorded our first show. It's kind of wild thinking that we're doing that, but glad to be back in the saddle. We're again doing this still remotely. But you know, maybe the season we'll get to record again together in one physical location.
In the same way that, like, maybe there'll be a full stadium and a Premier League match at some point in time. Who knows?
Hey, we'll see. There were fans in the stands at Mapfre Stadium in Columbus just this past weekend, so anything could happen.
Yeah, 1,500 fans up there at I don't know. I still call it Cree Stadium. I'm not buying the Mapfre thing. Hey, what are you drinking tonight?
At the moment, I'm only drinking caffeine. Hit it hard a little bit over this past weekend.
And it is Labor Day that we're recording, so.
That's right. So I'm just trying to keep myself awake at the moment. And, you know, if nothing else, if I can stay alive, I can say that maybe the stream will stay up with me.
Well, I'm going with the Maker's 46 cask strength. So it's delicious.
Yeah, you've spent most of the pandemic just waiting outside of liquor stores, collecting various forms of bourbon.
Got to do something during the pandemic. Might as well stand in line waiting for booze.
That's right. Just make sure you're maintaining the social distancing while standing in line.
Sure.
Well, as we make our return to the podcast for season 8, we got to do the thing that no one cares about us doing, but we do anyway out of obligation to mainly ourselves and, like, the three people who just boss our leagues. But the fantasy leagues are back, just reactivated the Premier League version of that just last week. So that is back up and running. If you are a member of the league and you have reactivated your account, you are back in that again. If you did not do that, we'll be posting the link several more times over my Twitter feed over the coming weeks. So make sure you join up. We've again partnered with my other company, Added Time Outfitters, to provide monthly winners. So if you accumulate the most points over the course of the month in our league, you'll win yourself a free wristband from Added Time. We've continued to add to the line over the summer. We're now up to 30 wristbands. We've got another dozen coming over the next couple months, so definitely keep your eyes peeled for that and stay tuned for further giveaways there. So MLS League is back up and kicking as well. We'll be announcing monthly winners there too. I didn't bother to look it up because I'm sure, like, neither one of us have even logged in at all.
Nope, didn't even know it started.
Yeah.
Didn't know any of this counted. Yeah. I thought, that's right. Much like Atlanta United, I thought 2020 was just not really real. And we could just...
We'll get to that a little bit later on in the show. But let's go ahead and get into things. The Premier League is back. Not to confuse that with MLS is back. I don't know if we're violating trademarks or something.
Is there going to be a Premier League is back tournament?
That would be sweet if there was. I'd watch that and enjoy it a lot.
What's the Orlando equivalent in the UK?
Portsmouth.
Like, is there some town that's got like the big amusement park that everyone goes to? I don't know what that place would be.
Isn't there one in the like the opening credits of Sunderland Till I Die? Isn't there like a Ferris wheel or something? Right.
Sure. I mean, kind of a gross looking one, but sure.
I mean, I'm just spitballing here, but no, there is no MLS style is back tournament. It's just standard Premier League that we're getting here after the abbreviated summer break. I'm excited about it. Despite the short layoff, it does feel like we basically just took like an elongated break. I'm excited for it to be back, just because of the monotony of all this, like not having games on like every other day. I feel like I've been deprived a little bit in some respects. So I'm just happy to have like regular football back on again.
Yeah, that restart got us so spoiled with having Premier League matches basically every other day. I think what that entire restart, there was like five total days where there weren't matches. It was amazing. So we were all drunk off of that, and then now we had to had to have a dry month, dry August. But we're ready to go. And that means we're ready to make our predictions. As always, we do our top four, our relegation candidates, our dark horse team. So basically, we always keep the definition of this one kind of ambiguous. It's basically just a team. Doesn't mean they're going to do anything crazy. Doesn't mean they're going to all of a sudden, like, contend for the league. We're not saying that. We're just saying, like, a team that's going to be a lot better than you would think they would be, and a team that ends up being kind of a tough out that you would otherwise not suspect them to be. So I think kind of the consensus, the last couple of seasons, if you want a good example of that, is like Wolves.
Mm-hmm.
Wolves is a team that, they came up a couple years ago, they came back up, and they made all these moves, and they just started just kind of crushing it and getting up and around European places and just kind of hanging around like that top eight area and making that just one more team on the schedule for everyone else. That's like, yeah, this is actually going to be like, we're going to have a fight on our hands. That's kind of what we're looking at. We're a team that is just going to be more of a handle than maybe some would suspect.
Yeah. To give you an indicator of our success rate in hitting this ambiguous rule that we've made for ourselves, intentionally ambiguous so that we don't necessarily look more stupid than we actually are. Neither one of us picked Leicester the year that Leicester ran themselves to a title. So
I feel like I probably had them as like a relegation candidate.
I'm certain that we both had them as relegation candidates, especially given kind of the campaign that they'd had before that. But anyway, that is our dark horse candidate. But those aren't the only predictions we make.
Right. And then we'll also do our golden boot, our manager of the year, and then, of course, the all-important sack race. Going back to the dark horse, though, the dark horse is the only one that, like, it's also ambiguous, like who actually wins that prediction, right? Like, we know who wins the sack race. We can look it up. Obviously, we know where people are going to finish in the table when it actually happens. Manager of the Year award generally actually is not awarded by the time we do our final pot of the season, but we generally have an idea of who's going to win that. Sure. Of course, it's just kind of like, oh yeah, I guess that sounded like you made a decent prediction. So yeah, that's it. I know we got a few people submitted some predictions. I think most people kind of went in are just like, wow, I didn't realize we're already going into a new season. I completely forgot.
I'm not ready.
Yeah,
I'm just thankful for Google Calendar alerts, because otherwise I feel like I probably wouldn't have even known the season was going to start and that we even needed to record this show to begin with. So let's get on with those predictions.
Yeah. And, real quickly, like, we hadn't had that like long off season where we're constantly talking and toiling over what team is going to do what that's going to look like. The ins and outs, obviously with it being a shortened off season, and then obviously just the economics of the pandemic world that we live in, like most teams weren't really just going crazy with the money. A couple were, one in particular, we'll get to them. Not many teams were like looking to just like make it rain.
Yeah, that is true. But there have been a lot of people making kind of chess moves in the background, and
certainly
a lot of sliding parts and pieces and narratives that have changed along the way. So let's get into those predictions and start where we normally start with our top four. Should we independently just be like, all right, here's our top four. Just you go.
Yeah. I'll give mine. You give yours, and then we'll kind of work our way through some of those teams. Okay. So for me, I have fourth place Manchester United, third place Manchester City, Chelsea in second, and Liverpool repeating as league winners.
Bold predictions there, sir. We actually had the exact same top four, but not anywhere close to the same order for the teams themselves.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Let's hear it.
So I had City in first place, much as I did, I think, last season. Mm-hmm. Chelsea, I also had in second, so I shared that with you. Liverpool, I had slipping all the way down to third place. We'll get into the reason for that here in just a moment. And then I also had Manchester United in fourth. So a bit of a topsy-turvy look at what you had, but it seems like we're kind of in the same position. I'm thinking these are probably going to be the top four sides in England this year.
Okay, let's start with Manchester United. You had them fourth?
I did.
Okay, and so did I. You know, my big lingering things with Manchester United, I think they're good enough to be a top four team again, like they were this past season. There's still a lot of question marks with this team. Obviously, there's some addition to the back line that sounds like they're still ready to make. So they bring in Ighalo last season as almost like a striker option band-aid to help fix that issue. But they still, I think, are lacking a solid striker up top. So I question if they still have enough pieces up front. And then we still don't really know what this year will mean for the future of key players like De Gea and Pogba.
There are a lot of question marks that are hanging over this team. And I think that's the same reason I left them at the bottom of my top four rankings. I think there's just so much talent in the squad now. This isn't like the team a few years ago where you kind of looked into that team and went like, all right, there's like one world-class player in that squad. And now I feel like they've got, you know, a handful of them at minimum. And whether or not they make use of all of them is certainly open to debate still. But I do think they have the tools to at bare minimum squeak their way into the top four. I do think that the Pogba situation remains really interesting. There's the chance that he could still leave right now, but I think just the pandemic has made it way too difficult for a player on the type of wages and kind of package and type of money that you'd have to drum up to exchange a player of his type. I just don't know that it's really possible for him to make that move now. So I think they're going to be stuck trying to figure out at least through January what that's going to look like. But I do think they're too talented to not find themselves in the top four. And I think Ole is starting to find his feet a little bit as the manager of a club of that caliber and that size.
The keeper situation. Is that actually going to be one of the big sticking points for them with, you know, De Gea had another suspect season, and now what, they're going to bring in Henderson to give it a go, right? He's going to have a try at least being in the discussion, correct?
I mean, you would assume that's the idea behind that type of thinking. Look, I think the problem that United find themselves in is that finding a keeper, and this is always a bit of an issue with this particular position, but finding a keeper is going to be a little bit more difficult given that Chelsea are also really on the market now for a top level keeper too. And it basically it's a hard ask to say to a player, especially a foreign player who it will almost undoubtedly be, would you rather go to Manchester or would you rather go to London? And a lot of players will be like, yeah, I can get, about the same money and live in like one of the world's like most popular cities. Like, yeah, I'll probably choose London over that. So I just think it's a tough time for them to be on the market for an elite level keeper. And that's not to say that there aren't other top clubs outside of England that are also looking too.
All right, let's move on from them to, let's talk Liverpool. So I picked Liverpool to repeat. You picked them to fall all the way to third. My logic in them repeating is, I mean, they're essentially operating with the exact same squad that they just won the title with. I think most of their key pieces are still in prime years to where there shouldn't be a real dip in form. I think where I normally get leery about teams kind of holding firm, and to be fair, they do have a possible big move lingering there with Thiago from Bayern, but that's not happened yet, so we can't really go off the assumption that it will. I still think, even with it holding pat, that the team was just that superior that they're still going to be right there neck and neck. I think it's going to be it's not going to be the walk that it was this past season, where they were, yeah, where it was a foregone conclusion by Christmas. I think this is going to be a real dogfight. I think Chelsea and City are going to be right there at their heels, but I think they still pull it off.
I thought long and hard about Liverpool and what they're going to be this season. And I, on some levels, I totally agree with you. Like, you look at how they were just an unstoppable force through a large chunk of last season. And, you saw that they had a bit of a dip, a very noticeable dip in form after the return back. I mean, they had all but sewn up the league even before the return had come back. And they barely needed to do anything to secure that long-awaited title. And they finally, to use a crude term, popped that cherry and got that out of the way. And you can understand them kind of mentally turning off a little bit and checking out. And that maybe being an explanation for that dip in form. But I'm also going to draw some parallels to prior to the pandemic break, they were a little bit fallen off the edge a little bit too, and they'd just been knocked out of Europe. They hadn't particularly been great in cup competitions either. As great as they were in the Premier League, they did show some weaknesses after the return, and they showed them before the return too. So they've been performing at an unbelievable clip for about 2.5 seasons now. And yeah, they were really, really good the year before they won the title, where they just narrowly lost out to City. And I find it really hard to see them maintaining that level of dominance for that long. And I just, as good as they are, and I don't think they haven't dipped. And even if they don't make any big acquisitions, I don't know that really hurts them at all. I just don't know that they can keep doing what they've been doing.
So I guess my one question on them, you've kind of answered, and it's your reasoning for putting them third, which is, do they have the means to repeat?
I mean, the answer is yes. I mean, they clearly have the capability of winning a title. They've proven that and without dispute. But, man, repeating is hard, and there's a reason why we haven't seen a ton of it in recent times in the Premier League, especially with the wild influx of money into the sport. It makes it a lot harder to repeat that type of feat. So I don't know. I mean, we've seen it happen enough in the Premier League era that it's not unthinkable. And I think it's even likely, but I wouldn't be surprised at all if Liverpool aren't capable of defending the title this year.
So I have Manchester City being the team that slides to third, and you have them winning it all. So my thought process, I just have the, I don't even know if I can pinpoint why I feel this way, but I just have this lingering feeling that the window is starting to close on Pep at City. And we already actually even had rumblings of this towards the end of last season of like, is Pep bored with this job? Is it, you know, the last mountain for them to climb is the Champions League. And they've found themselves unable to pull that off yet again. And I wonder if there will become a fatigue with Pep. And could we start to see that now where he just doesn't have that zeal for the project that he did in those first couple years? I think that this is an extremely talented team, but I still do think that there's like some parts that may be getting to that point where it's like, is this where you need to swap it out? Like I look at Aguero has been a goal machine for, you know, half a decade now. That normally you don't make it that long of just being a consistent goal machine. Like, so when does that start to fall off the table? Where Aguero is not going to give you the production and you're going to have to start relying on someone else, or you're going to have to start shopping for someone else possibly in January. And then on their back line, you know, they make this move for Ake, which is great. Ake is a great player. But I just don't know if it's enough. I feel like they're still missing, you know, they're still chasing what they lost with Vincent Kompany, and maybe Ake brings a little bit of that, but I still do think that they're in need of maybe one more big piece for that back line.
Yeah. I mean, I totally hear you. And much like I was saying with Liverpool, I spent a lot of time thinking about what City are going to be this year. And I do think we are like on the precipice of this era that Pep has overseen at City, and think this is kind of the all or nothing year for him. And, you know, he's gone beyond his normal 3-year stint at the clubs, as he's done at Bayern and Barcelona before this. So he's already broken a little bit of precedent in that respect. But I think, and I totally agree with you, like Aguero is, he's showing some signs already of breaking down and wearing down, and getting these more routine, regular, long layoffs, I think is a bit of sign of the times. But I do think they just have enough. They've invested enough in this squad, at least in the front half of it, that they've got at least a season or two left to grind out of them. And you're looking at some guys like, Jesus, if he can come good and really make this his season, where he's the breakout player that they've hoped that he would develop into, that would be huge for them.
He kind of has to be, right? Like, if he doesn't take the reins this year, they go out into the market next summer and bring in a top striker, right?
Oh, for sure. Or maybe even as soon as January, as that matter is concerned. And a lot of that depends on where they sit in the table and how Kuhn is performing too. But I agree with you. I think they have made some signings. Ake, I do think, fills some holes for them. And if they can get some of these other players fit in the back, I do really think that will help them a ton. And both Sandler and Laporte, if those two in particular, I think, can get fit, having a guy like Ake, who's so mobile for a center back, I think will be a good foil for those type of guys who are a little bit more traditional center backs, at least how you would think of them. So I think if he's going to have a year where it all clicks, this might be the year for him. He's going to have kind of peak De Bruyne if Jesus can come good. I think those are some opportunities for him to really make this his big year at City. Whether he can turn that into a Premier League title and a Champions League title, well, that's another question entirely. But I do think this is a good year for him from the Premier League perspective.
All right. And we both had Chelsea finishing second. This is obviously the side that has made the most off-season news, the most transfer news. I've equated what they are in the process of doing to, you know, being their biggest summer transfer window since the summer of 2004, when they brought in guys like Paulo Ferreira, Petr Cech, Ian Robin, Didier Drogba, Ricardo Cavallo. Those guys all came in that same window and were meant so much to those two titles that came right after that. And obviously you got guys like Cech and Drogba that then became part of the spine of that club for years to come. And here they are, like, doing a very similar move here, where they are bringing in, they bring in Timo, they bring in Kai Havertz, they go and get out of nowhere Thiago Silva on a free, they bring in Ziyech from Ajax, and then they're still possibly, most likely, bringing in another keeper to compete, which possibly could be Mendy from NA, and maybe someone else. I don't know. No one really knows what's happening there. I think it's going to be Mendy because I don't think they're ready. While they're willing to spend crazy money elsewhere, they seem to be a little shy of wanting to spend big money on a keeper again, because they just spent big money on a keeper and you're already possibly starting to move that guy out in Kepa. And then you possibly still have, and then they bring in Chilwell, and then they possibly still might bring in Declan Rice to also be part of that back line. Just a crazy transfer window where this entire Chelsea side that also at the same time, moved out Pedro, moved out Willian. They are kind of reinventing themselves and getting themselves a new identity. And really, for Frank, this is going to be no room for error. He just got a giant infusion of talent. So he kind of has to make it work, right? Like, there's no like, oh, well, we had a ban and I had to just play all the pups. Like, that's gone. Like, they just basically just went blank check style and just bought everything they needed. So there's no excuses. So my question is, A, will this work out? And then B, what about those 2019 pups? What about the Mason Mounts and the Tammys? Guys who were given prominent roles last year still are rising stars, not just even in Chelsea, but, in England. These are guys that have cemented themselves as getting on those squads, and with the Euros and the World Cup just on the horizon, these are guys that are obviously going to need minutes to make sure that they get onto those squads and get into those tournaments. And at what point, if they're not getting it at Chelsea, are you going to see both of them move on? And obviously then that's, there is some level of disappointment in that, obviously, because these were like supposed to be, the Chelsea products turn good, and we might already be turning the page on them. So a lot going on.
Yeah, to say the least. So I'm glad you asked the question about will this all work. The quality that Chelsea have purchased is undoubtable this year. You mentioned guys like Kai Havertz, Timo Werner, Ziyech, who they signed in January last year, and he's finally making his arrival this summer. And then even Chilwell in the midfield, Thiago Silva. Like, these are all very good, proven players at the highest levels of the game. Great and good. That's a lot of new faces to integrate in, right? And like mm-hmm. you said, there was like this kind of cohesion in this thing that they built last year, this new group of people who came up through the academy, and everyone was kind of already tight-knit. And that was like their thing last year. And Frank obviously saw good in that, but also looked at it and was like, I need a lot more. And City clearly looked like a club that were forced to sit on their hands for a year. And like the money that they were accumulating, they kept in that pile for spending. And like everyone was kind of like, oh no, they'll come slow out of the gates. I'm like, what the hell are you expecting? Like, there's no way
why
they're not going to spend like maniacs this summer. And they've done that. But the question is, can you make that all work? And dropping like six influential, and we're not talking about like guys who are used to being like a cog in the machine. They're like guys who were the stars in their machines before. And not to say that, you know, in soccer you have to be the, you know, used to working as a unit, but if you aren't getting those normal minutes and influential moments that you're used to getting, how does that work for you from a psychological standpoint? How does that work from a unit standpoint? Does the same rapport get built up amongst the squad as you had last year? And then I think the biggest question outside of like the normal things that come from like a giant makeover that maybe even seems like a, if it ain't broke, don't fix it type of scenario, but it's more the inexperience that Lampard has in doing this. This is still what is like third full season as a manager, right?
Yep.
Like he's not like, Sir Alex Ferguson, who was just given a giant transfer kitty in his 20th season in charge of a major club. This is his third year in charge of this, a second in charge of a major club, and his third year overall in charge of a club, period. That's not a lot of experience. And as good as Frank's been, and I think he's been fantastic so far, is this in his wheelhouse? We don't know yet. And I think that they have so many neat pieces to be a truly special side. And I think they could be challenging for the title as soon as this year. But everything has to work out right. And I think that's a lot of ifs.
I think that's going to be a thing for a lot of the top sides as we start. You know, there's kind of three things working against most top sides right now, which is, A, they had to play extra matches after the Premier League season ended, so they were playing into August, so they basically had really no preseason. B, you know, there's new people that they're trying to bed in. And C, this stupid international break that they decided to plop down like days before the season starts, where you have key players, you know, off with their national team. So they're not even, you know, part of training in the, you know, 10 or so days leading up to your first match. Like, all three of those things are going to be a problem in some way or form for all of the contenders this year. But you're right. Like, Chelsea has all of those, like, to the extreme, right? Like, they're trying to bet in basically half of a starting 11.
Yeah.
Is new. They had to play two extra matches past the end of the season. So they've only played one preseason friendly at all. And that's all they're going to play because they're not playing anything this week. They had a handful of players, including ones that there are new and they're trying to bet in, off at national team duty. So I could see a lot of the big clubs kind of have a little bit of a stumble start here in these first couple weeks as they're trying to kind of get themselves, you know, kind of up and rolling for the season with really, you know, they didn't really have the runway that they normally had.
Yep. No, I totally agree with you and think that could be an opportunity for some of these clubs that we don't normally see cracking the top four, making a run and making early statements in the season. So we'll have to wait and see what that ends up looking like. But definitely some stumbles awaiting many aside in this yet again weirdly impacted Premier League season.
Let's go dark horse, and then I just kind of want to hit maybe like a word or two on some of the other kind of, you know, big name teams, especially teams that a lot of people here in the States follow, so that we at least do some sort of preview on them. Your dark horse team is...
I feel weird even saying this is a dark horse team, but I Newcastle. I'm going to say it. I think right. Newcastle are, okay. are my dark horse team this year.
Announced Callum Wilson today, so that was a big one for him.
Yeah, and it wasn't just Callum Wilson. You know, they've made a couple other nice moves here and there to kind of strengthen the squad, and I just, you know, for a club that was in the news all summer long for potentially being a takeover from this basically the Saudi royal government, you know, they didn't get this investment that they were severely wanting and needing. But I think they've done some smart business as a result. And not that I think Steve Bruce is the best manager out there, but I do think I think this year they could make a little bit more noise than we've gotten used to seeing out of Newcastle in recent seasons.
All right, awesome. My dark horse, I'm going with Leeds.
Ooh.
You know, I think they've made a couple signings that were pretty solid, obviously Rodrigo being the big one. They were a really good – I mean, they tore through the championship pretty well. Like, they were definitely handling their business last season. And then, like, I don't foresee Bielsa rolling in with some kind of stinker of a team. I think he's not going to be a manager that's going to be that's going to outthink himself and make poor choices in how he approaches the Premier League season. I think he's way too smart for that. And I think that he is someone that is going to know, you know, how to get the most out of what he has, even if, you know, he doesn't get, you know, even if, you know, their roster isn't that of some of the other clubs, even in the mid table. I still think he's gonna be able to get more out of them. So yeah, that would be my pick. It would be Leeds.
Yeah, I mean, I thought about them a little bit. My fear with Leeds is that, and Bielsa has a history of doing this, although his stint with them in the championship goes to disprove this to a certain extent. But he has a tendency of wearing his teams out, and like they hit a point like midway through the season where they kind of like run out of gas. And the championship's a great proving ground in that there's more league games than what you would standard have in most traditional leagues. So it's a little bit more of a marathon than it typically is. And he clearly proved that he can get the most out of his team enough to elevate them into the next level while going through that gauntlet. So maybe he'll disprove me in that respect. But I agree with you. They've got some really cool stuff they've been doing in Leeds. They've got some exciting players. And you mentioned Rodrigo. There's also Jack Harrison, the former MLS standout NYCFC. And he's technically on loan for Manchester City. At Leeds, although I would presume he's probably going to stay with them again this year. So I hear your point. We'll just have to see if Bielsa can bring that magic again in the Premier League.
Let's do a word on a few teams. A word on Arsenal. Everyone kind of got a bit of a buzz about Arsenal. They win the FA Cup. They win the Community Shield. They're looking good. They've, you know, they made a move or two. Is this for real? Are they fool's gold, what we're seeing right now out of them? Is this kind of our typical thing with Arsenal where they have these little stretches and people get super excited and, like, Arsenal's back, and then we get what we've been getting?
I'm inclined to believe, and maybe this is the emotional side of me wanting this to be the case, thinking that they've kind of done this little gotcha thing to their fans yet again. Look, I would love to have had like all these gotcha moments that Arsenal have had over the last like 5 to 10 years, where they've scooped up like 3 FA Cup trophies or 4 FA Cup trophies, while Spurs have looked better in the league and done garbage in cups. You know, I would certainly trade a few of those off. That said, this feels like another one of their false dawns to a certain extent. I do like some of the signings they made. I think Williams a crafty pickup, in a free department sense. But at the same time, their problems are in the back, and they just haven't made a signing yet to me. And maybe I'm not looking closely enough at this point, but they've not yet made a signing that fixes the problems in the back. And that's really where I think they really need to focus their efforts. And until that's taken care of, I don't really see them getting back to the point where they're competing for the spots in the table that their fans would prefer that they would be.
A word on Everton. Carlo Ancelotti really flexing his I'm Carlo Ancelotti muscles and got some dudes to show up. Like they announced James Rodriguez today. I mean, that's kind of mind-blowing.
It's totally mind-blowing, but it also seems like classic Everton to a certain extent, right? Where they they went out and got, you know, a player like James Rodriguez, but like they went out and bought another 10. Like it's like they already have 5. Like, isn't that the same role that Gylfi Sigurdsson plays? Like they keep buying and Richarlison and like every other player on their team. I feel like they just keep going out and buying the same damn player and then like standing there and being like, why can't we make all this work every year over and over and over again? And it feels like that Einstein quote, like the definition of insanity is like doing the same thing and expecting different results. And they've again gone and done that. And yeah, it's fun to watch Carlo Ancelotti go out and reel in these big fish to a club like Everton. But like, again, it's a little bit like Arsenal. Like until they address the actual issues within that squad, like they're not going to be any better.
So like, so they bring in James, they bring in Allen. Will it work? And what does work? What does it working look like in Everton terms?
Man, I mean, the bar for them used to be Champions League qualification. I would assume they think that's what their bar still is. But I think like just getting into Europe again is probably the bar they should be shooting for, period. And if it's the Champions League, great. But let's focus on getting to the Europa League first.
A word on a little team we like to call Tottenham Hotspur.
Oh, man. First off,
year two of Jose. This is the big year, right? This is the year that the magic happens.
This is
where
it's supposed to be.
Time to make the donuts.
So let's start by saying don't spoil anything from the Amazon documentary yet, All or Nothing. I have abstained from watching anything. As you know, maybe our listeners aren't quite as aware. I'm pretty stingy when it comes to the streaming front of things, so I don't actually have an Amazon Prime subscription, so I haven't watched it yet, and I'm waiting for all the episodes to come out so I can binge watch them in like a 2-week setting at some point in the near future. That said, you're right. This is the year that it's supposed to work for Jose. Call me skeptical.
You guys have made, I believe, what, one move, two moves? Correct me here. How many moves have you made?
Two moves. So
you brought in the dude from Southampton.
Yep, Højbjerg.
And then the guy that had to delete all those Arsenal tweets.
Yes, that was Doherty. that was good. That is a right back. And he arrives to hopefully solve our Serge Aurier problem.
Where does he go then? Do you have more outbound happening?
Hopefully out of the club. The expectation is there will be a few departures here. We've already seen a few guys go out on loan as well as leave for permanent deals. So We're definitely expecting more changes, hopefully some more incomings, but I wouldn't expect too many more. The one that I'm really crossing my fingers for is the one that Spurs have needed forever, and it's like a true quality backup center striker. And the rumor was there a while, but I really want Troy Deeney. Like, I want him because he produces goals in crap situations, and that's what Spurs are so bad at. And I think he's the type of proven player who can come off a bench and still be an impactful player for you. But I think these are some good signings, but I don't know that they're enough to tilt the scales to get us moving in the direction that we need to be again.
What's your temp check? Like, where do you see Spurs finishing? A Europa spot again, or is that even a difficult road to hoe?
No, I think the Europe, at bare minimum, the Europa League is where they should be aiming for. But I think the squad's still capable of getting into Champions League places. I think if everything clicks, they could easily get back into the positions they were in last year, 2 years ago, where they're fighting in for, you know, top four, top two places, even particularly. But it all needs to click. And while I'm a big believer in Giovanni Lo Celso, he needs to find his feet appropriately this season and really be that kind of creative midfield presence that we've been lacking pretty much since Luka Modric left the club. And he's not quite your Christian Eriksen type, but he needs to fill those type of shoes and quickly if Spurs gonna find themselves back in those Champions League places.
All right, let's go bottom of the table. The sad news. Who are the teams that we are going to be bidding farewell to come May of 2021?
Let's start on your end of things.
Okay. And we'll just kind of do the same thing. We'll run through them and then kind of give our explanations. I got West Brom, I got Burnley, and I got Fulham.
Exact same three that I had in my
bottom.
Yeah.
All right. So West Brom for me, I kind of made my feelings about West Brom for years known. They haven't even played a match yet this season, and I'm already bored with them and their style of play. This is aside. If you look at this roster, unless I'm missing something, unless there's some move coming down the pipes that haven't taken place yet, they're basically going to be relying on Charlie Austin to do a job that he technically hasn't actually done since like the 2014-2015 season when he had like 18 goals in the Premier League.
Yikes.
That's they're going to need 2014-2015 Charlie Austin to show up. That's kind of the linchpin.
I was just Googling. I was like, man, who would even be leading the line for them? And you said Charlie Austin before I got there. But I was like, is Solomon Rondon still playing? Is there like main like number nine at this point? He's not. But that just kind of goes to show like where they are in the pecking order of things. And I agree with you. They've really not made any moves of note. Nothing, you know, unless they've unearthed a gem that we just are completely unaware of. I think they are the most likely candidate to go down by mile.
Burnley, I just think the magic runs out. They're facing down another offseason where they basically bring in nobody at all. Yeah. And they've done that plenty, and it's worked. But there's just no logical reason that's just going to keep on working. And I think we saw glimpses of it last season. I think the magic runs out. I think it's over. I think it's going to be one of those situations where it goes south real early. Dyche gets canned. And then they're just kind of a shell of themselves the rest of the way. They bring in whoever, you know, a Neil Warnock type. And it's just kind of a whatever team that slowly peters out.
I think we're all just hoping for an Alan Pardew sighting, if nothing else. But that said, I totally agree with you. I do feel like we're going to run into that situation ultimately with them. And it's sad to like condemn them already to that type of fate, but it seems so likely. And I agree with you. Like the minute they let Dyche go, well, will probably be the right decision. Like it's going to be like they just shot their soul. Like that club is so intertwined with the identity that he's given them over the last essentially decade. And I think they're going to have a hard time bouncing back and finding themselves any footing with a new manager, even if they make that change early enough in the season to have any sort of impact.
Fulham, for me, you know, it's funny because it's contradictory. My feelings on it is contradictory to the last time they blew this and they went down. Last time they went down because they went out and made like a million signings. And it was death by a thousand moves. And they just try to play this super attacking, we brought all in all these dudes style, and they just got their doors ripped off. This season, they're doing the opposite, and I think that's also going to be a bad move, which is that they've really not made a whole lot of big moves. You know, like the biggest name that they brought in, and it's actually a loan, is Mario Lemina, which that guy's career arc has been a disaster. It was in Juventus a couple years ago getting minutes. Then he was at Southampton, and now he's on loan at Fulham.
Never a good sign for your career progression to go in that particular direction.
But yeah, no, I think Fulham, you know, they were a team that put up a good fight and got through the playoffs to earn the spot. I really want Scotty Parker to succeed. Like, I'm a big fan of his.
Same.
I just don't know about this one, man.
Yeah. As great as Scotty Parker is, all I'm really hoping for this season is that they get desperate enough that they actually throw him onto the pitch. Like, that's
what
I'm for. I'm here for the player manager appearance, and I feel like Scott Parker is going to give us our closest look yet at that in the Premier League era. While we're sitting here talking about the sides that we feel like are going to get relegated, the natural thing to roll over to is sack race. And yep. I my manager comes from one of these three clubs. I don't know about yours. I'm maybe it's wishful thinking that Scott Parker won't be the guy getting the can first.
Let's hope not.
And I really don't want him to. And that's why I went and picked Slaven Bilic from West Brom. Mostly because he's already been canned by a Premier League side in his career at one point in West Ham. So why not like see him get canned again?
I also picked one of the relegation sides to lose their manager. And you know, and while the opportunity was there for me to pick David Moyes, and that should have been my move just based on the everything about me, I'm sticking with this narrative that Burnley, everything just goes wrong. And I think it's going to be things are going to go bad. Things are going to really get sideways. Sean Dyche is going to get sacked because it's, you know, he's lost the locker room and he's finally, you know, lost his magic. And yeah, I think he will be the first casualty.
All right. Well, we will wait and see who actually falls on the sword first. Let's make a slightly more positive prediction here now. Move over to some of these managers or you know, good awards that we might see people win. Who do you think is going to win the Golden Boot this year?
I think, and I don't feel comfortable making a homer pick like this, I'm going Timo Werner. I think he's just got the ability to pull it off. And, you know, if everything goes right, just the amount of talent he has around him to get him the ball, to play that ball in, he should have no problem scoring 20-plus goals.
Well, you've planted your flag in the ground.
I have. I don't feel good about it, and I have.
Yeah, speaking of things I don't feel good about, my prediction for Golden Boot is actually pure Aubameyang. I just I feel like even amongst the squalor, he continues to produce at a high level, and I think Arsenal have improved. So I can't see him not producing more goals if the squad around him has improved as well. So
I mean, he won it 2 seasons ago. He missed out by one goal this season. Yeah.
Kind of seems like the case might be strong for him to be in the contention again. So there's yours. Let's stay on that positive pass. Who do you think is going to get the Manager of the Year award this season?
Because I don't want to go Homer pick back to back.
Good.
I'm just going safe choice and saying Jurgen Klopp.
You know, I wanted to think a bit about this. I think it's incredibly unlikely that it's going to be Mourinho, so I don't have to worry about the Homer choice here. But I do think this is going to be a season where we see someone kind of outside of the traditional powers get it and actually do something with it. So who that's going to be, man, I've rocked a little back and forth on what that's going to be. And I think it is really going to boil down to if someone like a Bielsa can get one of these promoted sides to really outperform themselves. I think that's where it's likely to land. So I pick Bielsa.
Oh, yeah. No, if Bielsa gets Leeds to finish like 8th or 9th, I think he's definitely right up there for it. You know, the other one I was also thinking about is, you know, if Ancelotti makes good on these moves and Everton nips a Europa spot, I think he's definitely in the discussion then.
Yeah. Oh, I would definitely agree with that as well. Let's make our last predictions. These are the ones that we don't necessarily, you know, have any specific rules for. Once again, that makes it easy for us to not get these wrong, but these are our bold predictions for the season. So, for example, last year I pulled one out of the hat and was like, I think VAR is going to impact whether or not a team got relegated. And sure enough,
totally happened.
VAR actually impacted that. So we went ahead and gave me a at least a half mark on that one. But it's those types of predictions that we're making here. So what kind of crazy shit do you think is going to happen during this Premier League season?
So I'll give one that I'm really hopeful about because we love the guy. I think we get the return of Eddie Howe. I think one of these, you know, we're going to get, as we always do, 4 to 5 managers getting sacked throughout the season. I think Eddie Howe is hired by one of those clubs.
It's a bold prediction indeed. He is available for hire. So, I mean,
he's just there. Call him.
There for
get him on the WhatsApp.
One of my bold predictions is also on the managerial front, and it directly involves my squad, and that is Mourinho won't make it to the end of the season with Spurs, which is before his normal timeline of departures from clubs. Normally that's in season 3 that he bails out, but I've got a sneaking suspicion that now that the cameras aren't rolling behind the scenes at White Hart Lane any longer, Mourinho may feel like the door needs to be exited as well.
I have the opposite of that. Jose and Spurs win a trophy.
Ooh.
Could it be Europa? Could it be the Carabao Cup? Probably one of those, most likely, if it's going to be any of them. But
yeah, I don't care what kind of trophy it is. It really, the type of trophy matters not to me at all any longer. I just want any
break that duck.
Yeah. I'll take your positive message here. I did make another prediction here as far as bold ones go. I don't know how bold this really is, but there will be at least one match postponed due to the COVID.
Yeah, that was actually my other one.
Really?
Is that COVID causes cancellation is what I put. There will be matches moved, matches canceled, stuff jacked up. Because there will be a spike. There will be a something.
I mean, we saw
Phil Foden will try to sneak in some chicks again.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's Foden. That's Mason Greenwood. That's at least two of the teams in our top 4 begging for a COVID delay of some sort of capacity. So, I had the caveat that the postponement will happen to COVID within a squad. So, if we're taking bets on which team is most likely.
What if those dorks pull it off again and, like, it's the week of, like, the Manchester Derby and that game has to get punted because those two morons went out on the lash again?
I hope that's the case. Praying for it almost.
Anything else? Do you have anything else for the rest of our prediction preview? Tim Howard taking over for Kyle Martino's role?
Yeah.
Kyle looked like he probably needed some self-care time. He was kind of getting a little sideways on us there towards the end. So hopefully he's taking some time to get himself in a better headspace. But cool to have Tim back.
Yeah, I mean, it's good to have Tim back. I think from an analysis standpoint, we've seen enough of him to at least have some sort of idea of what he's going to be. I think he's a downgrade in personality, you know, if nothing else. I think, we had a little bit more charisma before, but now that Kyle is off, I think Tim's not a bad alternative. I wouldn't have hated to see someone like maybe, another look potentially for someone that hasn't gotten necessarily the time at a bigger network, but hey, we're going to take Premier League, whoever's commentating. And if it's Tim Howard or if it's, someone doing sign language, I'm still going to tune in.
Can't wait for that sign language. Let's move stateside real quick. MLS is going on this stage of the regular season. Is about to end. I have no idea what the next stage looks like. I don't think anyone does, including Don Garber. But that's happening.
We know that if Don Garber knew what the next stage three, looked like, which is supposedly a 12-game stage, it would have already leaked to The Athletic. So,
right.
It's a pretty good shout that they probably have no clue what they're doing yet at this
Paul,
point.
Paul Tenorio would have already been handed that memo.
Yep.
So I just wanted to hit on a few things because there's not a lot of like crazy things going on. There's also just like there's no point in breaking down matches because everyone's just playing the same three teams right now. So it's just kind of whatever. Mm-hmm. But there are some things that are becoming clear. And one of those things, and it was clear in the tournament, and it's clear now in this second stage, Columbus Crew are like a really good side. Like they're probably the best team in the East.
Yeah, I think it is interesting to kind of see the work that Caleb Porter has done now in his second full season with the Crew to kind of remake what was formerly Greg Berhalter's side, which was a good team, but this Porter Crew team right now seems kind of a step above that. And they really do seem a multifaceted side. And even when they're missing key pieces, like Zella Ryan didn't play at all against FC Cincinnati last time out. They still look formidable. So, he's really got them ticking and playing in a really fun way. And they're not just playing entertaining attacking soccer. They're also not giving up goals either. They've only given up like 2 goals all season long, which is just an absurd statistic, even given the kind of craziness that has been this campaign. So, they definitely look like a good side. And if we get to have an MLS Cup this year, they're definitely one of the favorites, at least this stage in the season.
I was talking to someone about it today on Twitter. You look at some of the acquisitions they've made recently, bringing in room to fill in for after Zach Steffen left was kind of a low-key move. Like, I don't feel like it got that much buzz when it happened, but like that he's turning out to be one of the best keepers in the league. And then, like, they just in a very just nonchalant no big, you know, transaction craziness to make it happen. Like bringing in Darlington Nagbe and the role he has played. Like they make all of these smart moves. They bring in, you know, they bring in a guy like Zellerion, which, like, if there's any MLS general manager out there right now that's, like, caught off guard by the fact that Zellerion is working out, like, they should, off that alone, probably not have a job. Because if a guy like that is just, like, squeaking by you and you just are completely oblivious to talent like that, that's an issue. But, you know, it's weird because I think from a Cincinnati standpoint, we should be looking at Columbus and like saying, like, this is how you smartly and carefully build an absolute contender in a small market.
Yeah.
And like, if they can do it, there is literally no reason why FC Cincinnati can't build something successful like that. If the crew can do it. So all of the crap about, you know, all of the good players want to go to the big clubs or to the clubs in the big cities. You can do this. You can do what the crew does. You can do what, you know, some of the other teams that have done in the past, you know, like a Sporting Kansas City, and you can make it work. Like you don't have to go. It's not a make or break on if you go out and get a bunch of like really good DPs. Like it's all the other things around it. You just have to do very well. And the crew have perfected that. And it shows right now this year.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it helps when you have a guy like Tim Bezbachenko, who's running the soccer side of the house, who's just insanely intimately familiar with the inner workings of MLS and has been around the block, had failures, had successes. Same with Porter. And when you combine those two kind of knowledge points with people who just know how this system ticks, they're able to combine the best of both worlds. They're able to lean on international scouting networks to bring in pieces that will fit into the equation. They know players that are successful in these types of environments because they've worked with them. Those are the things that make you really good. And it's not to say that people who have outsiders' perspectives can't do this. It's just a harder hill to climb.
Yeah.
And if you want a good illustration of why it's easier to go from that particular route, that's a perfect illustration. Two similar markets, very different stories in their evolution of clubs, but their resources are, let's just say, as far as we know, relatively the same. They're not going to be going out and making mega signings of, you know, like your Messies or your Lampards or whatever your type of marquee level players are going to be. But if you bring in the right type of pieces and fit them into the right type of equations, you can be successful in these markets. And the crew are showing why it's valuable to lean into those portions of the MLS landscape.
But now, if you were to say, if one of those two sides were more likely than the other to go and make that big money move, is it the team that's currently the best team in the East or the team that hasn't scored a goal since the tournament?
Yeah, I mean, I think everyone knows the answer to that question.
Speaking of teams that have spent a lot of money on players and it actually did work out, but now it's just all gone to hell. Atlanta United, they're basically just quit. Josef Martinez is out for the year. They flamed out pretty spectacularly in the tournament. They fire their manager, and now they're just shedding all their good play, like all their other big players. Pity Martinez already gone to Saudi Arabia, Qatar. What was that? Where did he go?
Yeah, somewhere in the Middle East. Not that deal's not yet done, but it's seeming.
I want to say Al Nassr announced it today.
Okay, well there you go. But it seemed like it was about to be done, even if it wasn't fully done. I think Barco is also looking likely to be leaving.
He's got apparently there's multiple offers on the table for him to go. You know, the Pity Martinez thing is the real, like, wow, what are we doing here? Because this was the guy that was brought in to replace the production of Al Marone. It didn't happen. There's been moments of brilliance, even as recently as like last week, but it didn't work out. And you can see that Atlanta sees what has happened to them this season and has decided, if we're going to make a change, if we're going to move in a different direction with some of our big signings and with our manager, who has not been named yet, now is the time to do it, right? I mean, we talked about this at the beginning when the season was going to restart with the tournament, and then you had like four or five players just miraculously end their season with getting some kind of major leg operation. If you were going to just kind of punt on a season, this was the one to do it. And you now have Atlanta and probably also the New York Red Bulls, two of your biggest clubs in your league and two of the biggest clubs out East. So even more help for the Columbus Crew because they have no competition now. Just basically saying like 2020 ain't our thing. We're just going to kind of take our ball and go home and just ride out these last matches.
Yeah. It is looking like that is the way that both of those clubs are going to be approaching the rest of this season. Look, we don't even know what the rest of the season is going to look like. So if there was ever a year to be like, screw it, let's throw in the towel, like this is the one to do that. So, a lot of moving pieces, particularly with the Atlanta situation. It's at least made things a little bit more interesting. But on that front, the unpredictability spreads elsewhere. Like LAFC have been garbage.
Since Baylor going down, and they've kind of been a mess.
Mm-hmm. LA Galaxy are now like kind of good again.
They're kind of good, but like, what is happening with this whole Chicharito thing? Like, is he hurt? Is he just not ready yet? Was he never ready? Like, I don't get what we're doing here. Yeah. Like,
yeah, it's a little bit of a weird one. It's a weird time in MLS right now, and no one really knows what they're doing. No one knows necessarily what their game plan is yet for this season. There are certainly some teams that are clearly going for it, but I'm hesitant to define a narrative for this season at this point.
Let's go winners and wankers and wrap things up.
Yeah, sounds like a good idea at this point. I'll go ahead and get started with my winner this week. I'm going with new Schalke signing, Bosnian forward Vedad Ibisevic, who's announced he's donating all of his annual salary this year to charity organizations, meaning he's only going to earn money for himself off of performance-based bonuses. He also additionally rejected and confirmed multiple more lucrative offers in favor of going to work for Schalke, simply because they were so open to this idea that he was presenting to them. So I just think that's, you know, we see a lot of these players who are like committing to this like 30% plan where they plan to give 30% of their earnings back to the community. And this is just a very extreme version of that, and kind of shows that not all pro athletes are garbage human beings, and that there are some really cool ones that are out there trying to make the most of the positions that they've been given themselves.
My winner seems so much more shallow after you did that one. My winner is the Ted Lasso show is actually really good.
Oh, is it?
Dude, it's really good. Like, it's super enjoyable. They actually like flesh out the characters like really well, where like it actually makes sense that the show exists. It's funny, it's just good. Like, it's just good. Like, it's just super enjoyable.
Well,
I don't know if you got Apple TV. I think all you have to do is buy an Apple product at any point in time and they just give you a free year of it. So
maybe it's time to upgrade the laptop.
Yeah, I think you can literally just buy those stupid earbuds and they'll give it to you. So, but yeah, no, it's super enjoyable. It's actually really good. I mean, obviously going into a TV show based technically loosely off of a commercial ad from like 5 years ago, the bar was set pretty low, and they definitely exceeded it.
Well, Now you've given me yet another streaming service that I have to figure out how to get into. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah. My wanker this week, I'm going with the attention horror of world soccer at the moment, Leo Messi, for basically yanking us all around for 2 weeks, making everyone think that he's going to do something, and then he ends up doing literally nothing.
But was it that, or was it like him just being completely foolish about his own contract situation? Like, he seemed to be the least educated about his contract situation out of everybody in the process, including like you and I sitting at home.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I that's part of it. It always seemed to me like it was at least 50% down to like they really wanted the president of the club out. They wanted Bartomeu out of the club, and Messi knew that he was the one who held the keys to that situation. And he was like, I'm going to leave. And then once the guy promised that he would resign, then Messi would stay. I kind of thought that was going to be the arc that we would see here, and that's what they kind of thought they were doing from the start. But then as they like got deeper into this, they were like, well, wait a minute. Like, people in the press are saying that maybe like because of COVID, like the contract situation is a little bit fuzzier than we thought. Like, maybe we can move this into a – it's almost like midway through – they decided, well, shit, let's see if we can pull this off then.
Let's do this and for then, real.
Yeah, like it always kind of felt like the political pressure move of just getting the club president removed and Messi installing or backing like a favorite. And then like he tripped into like, okay, well, if this might be a move, maybe I could get paid more and go do something different. But man, it seemed such like a petty move, and for like the way that everyone like looks at him versus Ronaldo, like at least when Ronaldo's left, he kind of made it clear like, hey, like my time's done at these clubs, it's time to move on.
Yeah, I know.
With he's Messi, it's kind of like he's yanking back and forth, and he has been for the last few years.
But I mean, it does seem like he's kind of the guy that's like, this is my last year, nothing you can do about it. So I'm just going to kind of speak my mind about the fact that I don't like anybody that's running the show.
Oh yeah, for sure.
I mean, I think we're setting up for a spicy final season of Messi at Barcelona.
It could be dramatic.
My wanker, we mentioned it a little bit ago. But the brain trust of Foden and Greenwood, Phil Foden, Mason Greenwood, removed from the England squad for basically trying to smuggle in Instagram chicks into the England bubble.
Amazing.
What a fail. And then they both put out statements like, oh my goodness, what a poor judgment by me and blah, blah, blah. Like, dude, you just, you know, you were presented with an opportunity and you're a 22-year-old kid. Of course you're going to jump for it.
Yeah, I mean, it's the least unpredictable thing imaginable. It also just goes to show that, like, if you think that they weren't doing this at home, like, you're a little foolish. Like, yeah. Just because they only got caught here because they were at a team hotel. Like, that was the only difference. Instagram chicks weren't quarantining. You know what I mean?
Nope. So, so the England national team apparently did not push out the stringent rules that the NBA wisely did early on in their bubble situation to nip that one in the bud, because they saw that one coming.
Sorry, you have to actually know the person.
Yeah,
and following them on Instagram is not enough.
I DM them on Instagram is not good enough.
Yeah. Well, that brings us to the end of the first episode of season 8 of the Wrong Side of the Pond podcast. Thanks as always for joining us. If you want to get a hold of us, there are ways to do that. Jeremy's at Jeremy Lance. I'm at Wrong Side of Pond on Twitter. Get a hold of us there. That's the best way. Otherwise, hang in for Who knows how many episodes this season is going to be? It's normally like 40 episodes, but you could be blessed with another extra 10 or something along those lines like you got last year.
Yay!
Just what everyone wanted.
Oh, my God.
50 episodes of DJ and Jeremy.
I hate to break it to you people, but if we have another stoppage in the season and have to come up with different material for pods, we're just rerunning those top 10 lists from last time.
That works for me. That works. Evergreen content.
Absolutely. All righty, folks.
We'll talk to you soon.
Bye. Can we have a little less talk? Can we